point and enjoying 14 August Independence Day. A very happy Independence Day to you all. Here I am with lecture number 14. I have taken it from last unit of your book. That is unit number 22. Since it's a play, so I wanted to do it first. The title of the play is Progress, and the writer is Saint John Greer Erwin. First year English compulsory. This is Sumaira Zaheer from Army Burnhull College for Girls. First of all, about the writer, the author, Saint John Greer Erwin. He was an Irish biographer, novelist, critic, dramatist, and theatre manager. He served in the Royal Dublin Fusiliers during World War I and suffered an injury that resulted in the amputation of one of his legs. Erwin worked as the manager of the Abbey Theatre from 1915 to 16. His 1956 biography of George Bernard Shaw was awarded the James Tait Black Memorial Prize. He died in London in January 1971 at the age of 87. First of all, what are the features of drama in literature? This question is always asked from you people. A drama or a play is a piece of writing or literature that is presented almost exclusively through dialogue. Like a short story or novel, it has a setting, characters, plot, and even symbolism. Now, if we talk about progress, so there are total in two major characters: Henry Corey, Professor Henry Corey, the scientist; Mrs. Meldon, his sister; and Hannah. It's a minor character. She is the servant of the house of Henry Corey. The stage diction defines the time, place, and introduces characters. Time is 1919, after the First World War. And the place is the laboratory of Sir Professor Henry Corey. And the play is one incident, or it is also called one act play. The conflict in the play is when Mrs. Meldon discusses with Henry about the invention. The climax when Mrs. Meldon wants from Henry to destroy the invention. Progress is a tragedy. We call it a tragedy. Then what makes it a tragedy? It has a tragic plot, which is very serious, and it is about war as well. A tragic hero is also there. Henry is a tragic hero. He must be morally good, above the average level. This is the definition of tragic hero. Elements of tragedy are action, the action which is moving from beginning to the middle, then to the end. And this tragic hero, Henry Corey, moves from good luck to bad luck. He did a mistake which led him to downfall. Now, the definition of ideal tragic hero according to Aristotle. Aristotle was a great Greek philosopher. According to Aristotle, it should be, in the first place, a man of eminence, prominence, name and fame. And then the actions of an eminent man would be serious, complete, and of a certain magnitude, as required by Aristotle. Further, the hero should not only be eminent, but also basically a good man, though not absolutely virtuous. This is the definition of an ideal tragic hero in a tragedy given by Aristotle. I have written the names of these are very famous characters or heroes of Shakespeare's plays, but these are all ideal tragic heroes because they all commit a mistake, and that's why, which leads them to downfall. Hamlet, Julius Caesar, Antony, Romeo, Lear, King Lear, and Macbeth. These are all examples of ideal tragic heroes. There are so many themes which are used in the play Progress, so I have tried to bring all of them. The very first theme of the play is, which is represented by Mrs. Meldon, who faced the death of her son. Mrs. Meldon had to face the death of her only son in a very strong way. She is bearing it, and her son died in the war, and her husband, who died of broken heart when his son died in the war. First her son died and then her husband died. The theme of the horror of war as well, the horrors of war is also there, which is significant theme in the play. The playwright, the writer, is using the diction, the language, which describes the results of war. Like he has used the language which tells what happens after the war. The theme of call for peace is also there. The struggle in the play between peace and war. Mrs. Meldon is calling for peace and her brother is calling for war. So this is also a very dominant theme in the play. The theme of loneliness is also there. Mrs. Meldon is totally living a lonely life after the death of her only son and husband. The theme of motherhood and the universal mother's feeling is also there. Like what the mothers, they feel at the death of their sons or loved ones as a result of war. The theme of suffering as a result of war is also there. The theme of selfishness on behalf of Professor Henry Corey is also there. First of all, what is a bomb? A bomb is an explosive weapon that uses the exothermic reaction of an explosive material to provide an extremely sudden and violent release of energy. A nuclear device no larger than traditional bombs can devastate an entire city by blast, fire, and radiation. The total number of military and civilian casualties in World War I was around 40 million. This is a description of an explosion of nuclear bomb. The devastation caused in Hiroshima and Nagasaki as a result of nuclear bomb. So this is the depiction of that bomb. This is so deadly, so drastic. Now, summary and analysis of the play. Peace hath her victories, no less renowned than war. It's a beautiful, beautiful saying of John Milton, a famous poet, English poet, who said it. Peace hath her own victories. Like, it's not necessary that you should raise a war to get renowned. Peace has its own victories as well. Progress by St. John is a successful specimen of a one-act play. It has not only a unity of theme, the abolition of war, this is the major theme, abolition of war. The unities of time, place, and action are also meticulously maintained. Thematically, Progress is written against the background of First World War, in which thousands were butchered, killed, and many more became disabled for life because so many their body parts were amputated. Amputated means some of the legs or arms were being cut down because of the disease or wound. It left many mothers childless, an incredible number of widows and orphans were there. This insensible devastation has created diverse reactions in social thinking. And Progress by the Irish playwright is just the product of one of the strongest of these sentiments, namely the anti-war feeling. Like this play is bringing before us the anti-war feeling of the post-war modern age. through the basic conflict between two ideas. Now the conflict is between two ideas. What are these two ideas? One is in favor of war, the other is against war. The point of view of the war mongering armed dealers, represented through the character of Kori, those who are producing new arms and ammunition, and those who are bringing the formula of new bombs, and that of the peace loving universal mother such as Mrs. Meldon. The drama has also sufficiently exposed the motive behind wars, which is to perpetuate and extend the class interest of the war. Mongering imperialists and exploiters who sit safe and secure far behind the fighting lines, and the poor soldiers sacrifice their lives in the trenches. The conflict is finally resolved in favor of the mother, or Mrs. Meldon, point of view of Mrs. Meldon, through the murder of Professor Cole. Peace here affirms itself through a little violence. True progress, it seems, necessitates the destruction of the means of destruction. It's a beautiful line again. You need to think or ponder over it. What does it mean? It seems necessitates the destruction of the means of destruction. We will discuss it afterwards. Indeed, there is a tragic severity in the revelation of Mrs. Meldon's austere, very strict and unfathomed, not fully known or explored bereavement, sadness, since she is in mourning, which is at the same time heartrending and saddening. The action, free from anything extra or redundant itself means extra, rushes to the crisis from the very stage of exposition. There is a surprise turn of events in the denouement. Denouement means conclusion or ending. And Professor Corey's murder by his sister, though tragic, is highly dramatic. At the outset, we find Professor is talking excitedly about his destructive bomb. In the beginning, we find Mr. Corey discussing his bomb and is busy with his experiment and his formula. He is happy and proud as his experiment has proved a success. His sister is in grief, and she is grief-stricken as she has lost her son in the First World War. So she lost her husband as well also after the war. Corey advises her not to think about the past, and he rejoices over his invention. He is very happy about his invention, as it can destroy a vast city in a few seconds. He says that his invention will make war in future over in a few hours. Like, you do not need many days to finish the war. So he is happy that my bomb will be able to finish the war within seconds or within hours. It is so deadly. He is also proud that the success of the war will depend on who strikes first. Like, obviously, one who is striking first with the very first blow of a nuclear bomb, so definitely the other country will be totally diminished or destroyed, and they won't be able to give a blow back. And what kind of weapons he uses? Mrs. Meldon gently reminds him that his invention will lead to the death of hundreds of young men like her son, Eddie. But he ignores her words and gloats over his invention. Gloats, he is very happy and blowing his own trumpet over his invention and the fame and wealth. He is thinking about getting very wealthy. He says that he will sell his bomb to the government, which grants him the highest amount of money. When Mrs. Meldon is convinced that her brother will not suppress his invention at any cost, she decides to do away with him along with his invention. She destroys the sheets of paper on which Corey has written the formula, but Corey is not upset. He says that the formula remains embedded in his brain. Like, you cannot destroy the formula from my brain. They are all embedded, all lying in my brain. And he can reproduce them easily. Mrs. Meldon cannot tolerate his inhumanity anymore. So when he stoops to pick up the sheets, he bends down to pick up the sheets. She stabs him on the back with a knife and kills him. She feels that this is justifiable revenge against the murder of her son on the occasion of his death anniversary. Erwin's Progress leaves a lasting effect of a full-length drama. Although it's a one-act play, it's very short, but it gives an impact of full-fledged drama. Since the play has little physical action, the interest of the play is maintained by its sharp dialogue. Like here, the dialogue matters a lot. Dialogue means the speech, the talks between these two major characters, because there is no action. There's just the speech, there's just the talks, conveying the ideological conflict of the characters. Each character has his own individual manner and style of speech, keeping parity with the character's bent of mind and point of view. The playwright, who mainly wrote for the Abbey Theatre, Dublin, implies shows his good knowledge of stage technique. The drama may also have an autobiographical element because it relates to the story of the writer as well. So that's why it can be called as an autobiographical, as the dramatist who had to go to war and face its horrors and atrocities, brutalities. In fact, he was fairly wounded in France and eventually he lost his leg as well. First of all, we will discuss the major characters. The basic character is that of Mrs. Meldon and Mr. Corey. Mrs. Meldon is a character from the play named Progress, written by St. G. Evan. The play was presented in 1919, just 1 year after the First World War. Mrs. Meldon was aged about 43. She is a sensitive-looking widow. She was suffering deeply from her memories. She is not a fretful, complaining woman who had suffered bereavement, and when in the course of play she speaks of her loss, she does so with grace and beautiful dignity, like she is still a very dignified woman. Her son was killed in the First World War and her husband died away out of heart failure. So she was the victim of adverse circumstances. She has a strong sense of tolerance. Beginning of her role. Mrs. Meldon's role started from the second scene when she returns from a long journey and her brother, Professor Corey, does not receive her at the station, and it was the death anniversary of her only son, Eddie. Qualities and character of Mrs. Meldon. Mrs. Meldon, as presented in the play, the qualities of Mrs. Meldon as presented in the play are: she's a dignified lady. Mrs. Meldon has a character full of dignity and grace. She's a lady who has faced the emotional sufferings of life, a woman having a compassionate, patient, gentle, sensitive and graceful appearance is what Mrs. Meldon looks like. She's dressed in black clothes, partly because she's a widow and mainly because it was third death anniversary of her only son. Her dignity becomes apparent when she opines about war, a bereaved widow and mother. Eddie was her only son who was killed in war. She had brought up her son with great care and love. She wanted him to be great in future. Her son enlisted himself in war. She could not decide to be happy or sorry, for chiefly she was happy. The sight of the messenger made her heart sink and she remained worried about her son. He came on his first and second leaves all safe, but he did not come for the third visit. He was killed in a moment by the men who had never seen him. This was the most shocking news. Her husband could not bear it and died away out of heart failure. She remained all alone in this miserable world. Now, I have brought the major lines of the play, and the rest you can read thoroughly yourselves, since it's a very, very lengthy play. So the major lines I have brought for your sake. The words of the play reflect her own loneliness. There are some words in the play or the lines which show us how lonely she felt. She says, I had a husband and a son when the war began. I had neither when it was over. Oh, this is so heart-wrenching, so heart-rending, so saddening. Like, I had a husband and son when before the war, and after the war, I had nothing. I'm the most lonely woman, cruelly alone, terribly alone. Her hatred for war. She hated wars. She considered them as organized butchery of young ones. She thought wars to be the most terrible things. She was responsible for the destruction of human peace. She wanted ban on wars. She wanted the scientists to stop making dangerous weapons or bombs. This was the war which made her widow and which snatches away her beautiful young sons. And in other lines she says, yes, people with broad views, modern ideas, because you are fools. Such people, you are fools. Someone like me, not clever, I'm not that clever like you, create beautiful things like my son. Like, I have given birth to a beautiful thing like my son, and you will all, your cleverness can only destroy it. And you people, you scientists, you modern people, you can only destroy such beautiful sons or boys. A brave woman. Mrs. Meldon was a brave woman in spite of losing all. What she said she had, she bore the tragedy patiently. She always suffered from old memories, but never showed her bereavement. She behaved as a calm and uncomplaining person throughout the story. Friend of humanity. On knowing that her brother has invented a dreadful bomb, she becomes deeply grieved. She opposed her brother and called him the most stupid man on earth. She cared for all the mothers as she had seen the fury of life. She wanted that other boys like Eddie must not fall prey to horrors of devastating wars. Mrs. Meldon, as a symbol of peace for all, did not rejoice at the wicked achievement of her brother. She perfectly reflected her friendship towards humanity. Love and peace can make the world a heaven. Again, she says on one point. War antagonist. Mrs. Meldon was a true well-wisher of human beings. She was totally against war because she thought that war was an organized killing of young people, a butchery of young people. She said that. She says, war is an organized butchery of boys. The lady wanted complete abolition of war. She dreamed that peace, love, care, and harmony should prevail in the world, and the earth should depict the shades of heaven. She's a passionate woman, and she was an enthusiastic person. She becomes extremely emotional when her brother denies destroying his invention. When Professor tells his motives to her, her limit of patience and endurance gets crossed. It will bring me fame and fortune. I shall be rich now, but more than that, I shall be famous. Mr. Corey says these lines. She grew extremely emotional and impulsive, and in the interest of humanity, she takes the matter into her own hands to save the human race from the deadly invention. She picks a knife and stabs her cruel brother to death. Then she says, to kill someone is also humanity if you are killing it to save humanity, but only for the sake of a nation, only for the sake of people. Now, some comments on Mrs. Meldon's act. Legally, Mrs. Meldon committed a crime by killing Professor Corey. She did not have the right to commit such an act of madness. But on the other hand, Her act seems to be justified for the sake of humanity. Sometimes a drastic and violent action becomes essential to crush wicked elements. In dismay, dejection, she said, "Oh, dear, dear Eddie, I had to, Eddie. And she's talking to Eddie. "I had to kill your uncle, Eddie. I had to kill your uncle to stop his brutality." She exalts herself in our eyes, and we begin to adore her as a protector of humanity. Conclusion: she was really shocked to know that her brother has invented a bomb which will destroy the whole nation within twinkling of an eye. She requested him that for the sake of young ones and for the sake of peace, he must destroy his invention. Her brother did not realize the intensity of her emotions and refused to destroy it for the sake of mere sentiment, so she killed him. In the end, she saw the wrath of son ruined, and out of sudden passion, she killed her brother, and then she wins the sympathies of the readers. Mr. Henry Khoury introduction, another major character. Out of three characters, these two are the major characters. The author titles the play The Progress ironically. He laughs at the attitude of warmongers and the scientists who believe that they are contributing to the progress of science. Like, this is the development of science. They think this is the progress of science, but actually it is the destruction of humanity. But the scientists, they think by inventing deadly weapons, they are developing science. And Professor Khoury, Professor Khoury, who is the playwright, has created a self-centered scientist, aged between 50 and 60. He's a self-centered scientist who is of the age of 50 and 60, who is a confirmed bachelor. His sole interest in life is his scientific experiments. He captivates our attention from the beginning till the end of the play. His wolfish snarls and physical features speak a lot about his inhuman behavior. He's a wicked person. He felt pleasure in destruction. He wanted to make the wars horrible. He invented a dangerous bomb full of corrosive gas which could obliterate whole cities within no time. He wishes to make the war so horrible that no nation will engage in one unless absolutely driven to it. He said, with a single bomb, we could wipe out the population of a city as big as Manchester. Like, we could destroy a city like Manchester within seconds with one single bomb. And same happened to Hiroshima and Nagasaki. They were destroyed within a blink of an eye during the Second World War. As a reputed scientist, there is no doubt he's a reputed one. He is a great scientist who is extremely dedicated and devoted. When the curtain goes up, we find Khoury engrossed in his experiment. His experiment is a success, and he has succeeded in inventing a lethal and devastating bomb, which is so powerful that, according to him, "I have discovered a combination of explosives," he says, "and gases that will obliterate thousands at once, thousands." He's so happy to think about the destruction of thousands of people. The above quoted words show the deep faith he has in the destructive quality of the bomb and his cruel nature and inhuman behavior. A self-willed person, he is extremely selfish and self-willed person. He's out and out materialistic. He has discovered the formula of the bomb just to earn name and fame and fortune, to get wealthy and famous. He's delighted at the thought that his invention would make him famous and well known all over the world. He did not care about the feeling of his sister, wanted her to rejoice his invention. He wished her to forget her tragedy and suggested taking a broad view of the point. He said, "Oh, a mother's feeling. Oh, you have a typical mother's feeling. Stop it now. Of course, you should be having these feelings, but look at the matter from a broader point of view, a broad vision. Put your own feelings aside. You must put your own feelings aside and look towards what we have achieved, what I have invented." As an unpatriotic person, he is crazy and unpatriotic. He wants to sell the formula of the bomb to any government which would pay him the highest price. He says, "I shall offer it first to British government, of course, but if they won't pay me my price, I shall offer it to somebody else." The above lines speak of his unpatriotic behavior and greed for money. As a cruel and heartless person, Professor possesses a very cruel disposition. His eyes reflect the coldness and seriousness. He is a devil in human form. To him, human beings are of no consequence. Even his sister's grief has no effect on him. Although he is aware that his sister is emotionally shattered by the death of her son, Eddie, yet he does not comfort or console her at her tragic loss. As an enemy of women, he is cynical about women and has a poor opinion of them. He thinks that women lack in concentration, have a fussy and talkative nature. That is why they are not very often crowned with success. According to him, your sex is most extraordinary, Charlotte, always thinking about or always lamenting about your own feelings. Corey's desire for immortality. Corey was mad for immortality. That is why he invented the bomb. He says, "This will bring me fame and fortune. I shall be rich. But more than that, I shall be famous. My name will live forever." Corey's tragic end. Mrs. Meldon is absolutely horrified when she learns of his terrible invention. She repeatedly requested him to destroy the formula. She says, "Henry, I beg you to destroy your invention, please." Professor pays no attention to her. So she, in a state of frenzy, madness, drove a sharp knife in his back. Corey falls on his face, dead cold. Thus the curtain draws on the play with his tragic end. There's a comparison of characters. Corey is playing the protagonist and Mrs. Meldon is playing the antagonist. So let's see the comparison. Corey is smart. Smart, obviously intelligent. He's a good man but has human mistakes. Selfish. He has selfishness. He's impatient. Coldness. He has coldness of feelings. He wants to destroy the world. He thinks about his own individualism. He is rational. He is not married. Because of that, he does not care about family. He loves his work very much. His age is 40 to 50. He's mad. He's wicked. He just cares about money and to be famous in the world. And Mrs. Meldon, she is his sister, nearly 40 to 43 years of age. Her son died in the war. She's sensitive, suffering, but still strong. She cares about family. She cares about humanity. She cares about other people. She wants peace in the world. She is a patriotic person, compassionate, cares for other children as well, and she is a very kind-hearted person. So here we come to the moral of the lesson. Moral of the lesson is, destroying the means of destruction is a step towards peace and prosperity. What does it mean? Destroying the means of destruction. Like, instead of inventing new formula of deadly bombs or new inventions or making new arms and ammunition or new weapons, we should destroy these things. Because this is a step towards peace and prosperity in the world. If we want peace and prosperity, we have to stop these means of destruction. we have to stop war. We have to create peace in the world, because peace will bring prosperity. There's a very famous quote of Martin Luther King, and I quote here, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that." It's a beautiful, beautiful quote by Martin Luther King Jr. Darkness cannot drive darkness. If you want to get rid of darkness, then you have to eliminate. You have to do it with light. If you want to get rid of hatred, then you have to bring love. You need to love others. You have to spread a message of peace and love to others, not hatred. So here we end with our topic. Do read it thoroughly. It's a very simple story with very simple lines and simple diction. So I have tried to bring or discuss all the questions present in the exercise in my lecture. So do listen to the lecture attentively and do take care of each other and spread kindness and humanity and try to get rid of hatred. Allah Hafiz. Take care. Goodbye.